Hi, today let us do an ideal case presentation of Squamosal CSOM, also known as Unsafe CSOM. With me is Dr. Purva, who will be asking me questions. I will be presenting the case and we will be demonstrating ideal flow of a case history it should be going. We will do this in three parts: history, examination and management. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
So I will be presenting this long case. My patient is a 32-year-old housewife. She resides at Katraj, Pune, and she presented mainly to us with the chief complaint of ear discharge from left ear for 2 years. Ma'am, she also has history of reduced hearing for 1 year. And now for last 3 months, she is giving a complaint of giddiness. So on eliciting detailed history, patient was completely alright 2 years back, after which she started having a complaint of ear discharge from left ear. The discharge was scanty. It was initially purulent, but then later on became mucopurulent. Continuous foul smelling. It also had some blood stain. There was no specific aggravating factor. However, patient says that during the episodes of upper respiratory infection, the discharge became slightly more copious. Patient took some local medications, but there was no relief with any medications.
Can you describe all the characteristics of this discharge?
Any patient with ear discharge, our main aim is to reach to a diagnosis. So by giving the description of discharge, we can differentiate an unsafe or a squamosal CSOM from a safe or a mucosal CSOM. Like in this patient of mine, the typical characteristics like scanty, blood stained, foul smelling, they describe a mucosal disease, a squamosal disease. However, if the discharge is copious, mucopurulent, intermittent, it would signify more of a mucosal or a safe kind of disease.
Okay, and why would there be foul smell and blood stained in any discharge?
The main reason for foul smell from the ear is because of saprophytic organisms. It is the unsafe CSOM or any CSOM mainly is caused by a mixed group of organisms. It is gram-negative, gram-positive, anaerobic. So gram-negative and anaerobic together, they give this kind of, they lead to foul smell in the discharge. And the reason for bleeding in case of a squamosal or a colostoma disease is mainly that there are enzymes which are released from the mixed organisms, and these enzymes they lead to osteitis and granulation formation, and this ultimately can lead to bleeding from the ear.
Okay, so what would be the differential diagnosis for blood stain discharge? Other conditions other than squamosal?
The common causes for blood stain from the ear, and the most common cause obviously is trauma if there is no history of discharge or anything. But if trauma is not the reason, then unsafe CSOM becomes the second most common cause. There can be vascular conditions like glomus, even in malignancy there can be blood stain discharge.
You told me the foul smelling discharge is due to organisms. What is the most common organism in squamosal CSOM or in chronic colitis?
Madam, CSOM, it's mainly a mixed infection which happens. Mainly there are gram-negative organisms like Klebsiella, Proteus, but also involvement of gram-positive like Streptococcus, also Pneumococcus also, and definitely the anaerobic organisms. And it is the gram-negative and anaerobic which are giving the foul smell in the discharge. Anaerobic Moraxella is the most common. Moraxella catralis is the most common, ma'am. Ma'am, my patient also has history of reduced hearing from the same left ear. It is for 1 year. It is gradual onset, slowly progressive. From this year, patient says she is having severe hearing loss. There are no specific aggravating or relieving factors, and the hearing loss is not a fluctuant kind of hearing loss.
How did you come to know that it is a severe hearing loss?
Though it is hearing loss only on one side, when patient is able to do routine activities, however, she says that when she uses the mobile phone from that ear, she is just not able to hear anything. So I came to conclusion that it is a severe hearing loss. Based on history, ma'am, a patient having bilateral conductive hearing loss, he will be speaking very softly because the self-hearing of the voice happens by the bone conduction. And in conductive hearing loss, the bone conduction is fine. So patient talks very softly. However, in case of sensory neural hearing loss, patient speaks very loudly. At the same time, he will give a specific history that he is able to hear, but there is lack of speech discrimination. Meaning, the clarity of speech is not there.
You mean the patient doesn't understand the speech?
Yes, not able to understand the speech well.
Okay. And you said this patient had non-fluctuating hearing loss, right?
Yes, ma'am. There is not any fluctuation in the hearing loss.
Okay. Then can you tell me the diagnosis of fluctuating hearing loss?
And fluctuating hearing loss, we can divide into conductive and sensory fluctuating hearing loss. The conductive hearing loss, the most common conductive fluctuating hearing loss most commonly is seen in case of Eustachian tube disease or otitis media with diffusion. In case of sensory neural fluctuating hearing loss is seen in case of Meniere's disease. During the attack time, the hearing loss aggravates, and when the attack subsides, the hearing loss improves. Even in cases of peritoneal fistula, patient will have a fluctuating sensory neural hearing loss.
Okay, can a patient with Squamosal have normal hearing?
Yes, ma'am. Many times, and there is so much of extensive colostoma that colostoma itself bridges the gap and causes the conduction of sound. It is important, ma'am, because a colostoma here ultimately we have to post the patient for surgery, and we need to counsel the patient that in such cases his hearing might deteriorate following the surgery. And the patient also gives a history of giddiness. He gives a history of two episodes of giddiness in last 3 months. Each episode was for 1.5 days. Patient had severe rotatory feeling. He took some medication from a local doctor, which was to be kept in the mouth, after which the giddiness subsided. The previous episode was 3 weeks back.
Okay. So, what would be the underlying pathology? What are the different things which
should
have happened, which led to
giddiness? And considering the history of ear discharge and reduced hearing and specific history, we need to keep in our mind that patient might be going towards complication. Rotatory kind of illness mainly can be seen in case of labyrinthitis, or patient might be developing labyrinthine fistula, and even in case of intracranial complications like a cerebellar abscess, patient might have a history of illness.
Okay, based on history, how do you differentiate between labyrinthine or cerebellar, which complication?
The only main differentiating feature in history would be that labyrinthitis patient will give a typical history of feeling of rotatory feeling. It's a rotatory giddiness. In case of cerebellar condition, patient says a history of more of imbalance or more of swaying from one position to another. Patient with cerebellar abscess means that he is going towards the intracranial complication. He might also have history of high grade fever, might have a severe headache. And as I said, cerebellar abscess patient will have imbalance, or the gait will not be proper.
Continue.
And coming to negative history, patient does not give any history of ear pain, no post or pre oral swelling, no neck swelling, no history of fever, no facial weakness. Patient does not have any double vision. He does not give history of any seizures, headache, tinnitus, neck stiffness. There is no speech or swallowing disturbance. Ma'am, this negative history, we mainly want to rule out any intracranial or the extracranial complications which can develop from CS, ma'am.
Okay. And you spoke about the postoral swelling and the neck swelling. What does it signify?
Ma'am, one of the extracranial complications is mastoid abscess, which is collection of pus in the mastoid region, subperiosteal region in the mastoid. So, postoral swelling rule out mastoid abscess. If the abscess trickles down along the sternocleidomastoid, it becomes a neck swelling which we call as Bezold's abscess. The pus can also extend into the external auditory canal skin, which is forms the Lux abscess. If it travels along the posterior digastric in the occipital region, it is called the Sedley's abscess. And sometimes in the preoral region, in the zygomatic part, it can form zygomatic abscess. So we need to rule out this complication. Ear pain, normally a patient of chronic otitis media should not have any ear pain, ma'am. So any patient having ear pain, there are mainly two reasons. And the most common is the ear discharge gets dried up in the EAC skin, and patient tries to clean and that excoriation leads to pain. However, even cases of mastitis will lead to ear pain. So any patient of ear pain, we need to rule out any complications that patient might be developing.
Okay. brain abscess is more common?
Ma'am, from as a complication of CS, ma'am, the most common brain abscess is a temporal lobe abscess, and second most common will be cerebellar abscess.
Okay, what would be the clinical features of the temporal lobe abscess?
Temporal lobe abscess, typically patient will have an absent seizures, and he also will give history of nominal aphasia, that is, he will forget typical names of the structure or common things.
Okay, and you told about headache. So, different types of headache which can happen in
CUL,
like in which etiology?
Headache mainly we want to rule out intracranial complication. Conditions like a subdural abscess will have a very dull, aching, boring kind of pain. And in case of conditions of meningitis, patient will have severe throbbing kind of pain. Also external abscessment, patient will not have any kind of pain. It is just a finding which we get mostly on MRI or when we operate.
What about the vision disturbance? What do we expect in case of
CUL? Ma'am, whenever patient, generally we ask for double vision because we want to rule out pitrocitis as a complication whereby the sixth nerve gets, that is the adjacent nerve gets affected, and because of this the lateral rectus palsy patient has a history of diplopia.
Okay, what are the other characteristics of pitrocitis other than diplopia?
Ma'am, because of irritation on the fifth nerve, there is also a retroorbital pain and ear discharge. So this typically constitutes a syndrome called as Gradenigo syndrome.
Okay. And you told about the speech disturbance too. So why would that happen in the case of CUL?
Ma'am, as we are ruling out complication, one of the complications is sigmoid sinus, also called as the lateral sinus thrombophlebitis. When it gets completely thrombosed, there is a chance that in the jugular fossa region, the 9th, 10th, 11th cranial nerve may get affected, and so we won't rule out speech and swallowing problems. So it is very rarely seen nowadays.
You mentioned tinnitus, so what do you want to rule out or what does it signify?
Tinnitus is a constant high pitch or low pitch sound that patient hears, and though the exact cause is not very clear, but generally it is accepted that a low-pitched tinnitus generally originates from the middle ear condition and high-pitch should be from the inner ear. So if patient would have given a high-pitched tinnitus, we would have thought that patient might be going into complication, though it is not proven as of now. That is all for the ear, ma'am. Patient continuing with negative history, patient does not give any history of recurrent upper respiratory infection like sore throat or recurrent rhinitis. That is all for history, ma'am.
Summarize your history and give me your probable diagnosis based on it.
Ma'am, so we are dealing with a 32-year-old housewife who mainly presented with history of 2 years ear discharge from left ear, history of reduced hearing for 1 year, and now has history of giddiness for 3 months. My negative history does not show any other complication except for the history of giddiness. So we are probably dealing with a case of unsafe or a squamosal CS, ma'am, along with a complication, most likely labyrinthitis. However, I would like to examine the patient and then come to the final diagnosis.